All right, so today we're going to be talking about raw food canine diets and the physiology and how that all works together. So if we look at traditional canine diets, there's a million formulations. You can do it off of their breed, their size, their age, their use. There's a ton. It's a huge industry in the US, so that's where the variety comes from. And on top of all the different formulations, there are also different forms. You can do a wet food, a dry food. The dry food's gonna be your kibble that you think of when you pour into like the dog dish. And there's also refrigerated foods, which is an up and coming formulation that's starting to gain a lot of popularity. But today we are going to focus on the raw food diet. It's a diet consisting of careful ratios between raw meat, bones, plant materials, and organ tissue. It's starting to gain a lot of popularity in the mainstream dog diet world, I guess you'd say, but it's not new. We're all pretty comfortable with the fact that dogs descended from wolves, and obviously a wolf is going to be eating a raw food diet, and kibble is kind of a new thing if you think about the history of humans. Go back to like the settlement of America, they didn't have kibble to their dogs then, they just kind of fed them what they ate. And so the raw food diet is going to be a lot more similar to what dogs would be eating if there wasn't human involvement. And this diet has been used a lot in the greyhound and sled dog industries. It helps with their fitness and they think it gives them more energy. So they've been doing it for just about as long as those industries have been around. It's pretty widely accepted that raw food has a lot of advantages. You get a lot of personal involvement with sourcing. For example, my dog, my goodness, if she can have certain chicken from America or Canada, but if you go into other countries, she starts to break out. Not quite sure about that, but I have to be really careful with sourcing. It can also be cheaper. I personally live on a farm, so I have my own animals that I butcher, and I have random cuts of meat that I don't use or I forget about and I get freezer burnt, and I can just use that because I already have it. There's going to be a few additives to the food. So some dogs are sensitive to like added colors, so you can take that out of the equation. It'll slow your food intake. My dad's dog inhales anything that's in front of him. And slower food intake is better for the digestion of the dogs, so that'll help them with that. And like I've said before, it's closer to what they'll eat in the wild if we weren't involved. However, there are a lot of concerns. If you go to just about any veterinarian, they're gonna kind of push you away from raw diet because of the pathogens, possibility for obstructions, and an unbalanced diet. So for pathogens, if you look on the left side of the slide, these are all the things that you're going to find in raw meat. This isn't really a new idea. We all know, like, think of raw chicken. You don't want to leave that out on the counter. However, we're exposed to this every day. And even traditional diets like kibble, they often have outbreaks of Salmonella, E. coli, Listeria, etc. And so you're not really getting away from that as much when you're on kibble. But a way to avoid this with raw diet is just to keep hygiene in mind. I mean, you don't lay a raw piece of chicken on your plate and then put cooked chicken on it. So you're gonna wash the dishes that you use to prepare the food. You're gonna wash your dog's dish once they're done, and of course, wash your hands. That's gonna help a lot with this problem. Next are obstructions. Everybody's seen on Facebook about dogs getting a big bone and they can't digest it, or it gets stuck on their mouth, and a lot of people really get worried about the bone aspect of a raw diet. However, if you'll notice, raw diet explicitly states to only feed your dogs raw bones. These are bones that are going to be uncooked, like they're seriously just straight out of the carcass. And this helps because there's more moisture, so they're more pliable. So you're not gonna have the splintering problem. You're not gonna have them so hard that they like break teeth. You can actually feed chicken bones as long as they're raw. It's that cooking process that really can become concerning. And next, really just observe your dog. If it's getting to a bone that's a little small, it looks like it could choke, you just take it away, throw it away, and you'll be fine. And if they're also getting dry, you'll take them away. Like if they take a really long time for a bone. And so pathogens and obstructions, those are the really major ones, but the dog was designed for these type of things. They have physiological defenses in place to take care of these problems. So Salmonella is one that's a big concern, and its lowest, you know, accurate pH level it can survive in is 3.8, and for E. coli, another prominent one, it can only survive in pH as low as 2.75. However, canine stomachs have a pH lower than 2. It's usually around 1.1, 1.18, I've seen both. That's gonna be 4 times as acidic as a human's stomach. So the bones and the pathogens, they're gonna hit the stomach and they're gonna be neutralized pretty quickly. So they're really designed for this. They don't have a huge problem with that. And then the next issue with raw diet, that's the one that I struggled with a lot, is balancing the nutrients. I don't want to inadvertently hurt my dog because I don't realize what I'm doing. And it can be really tricky and intimidating. Like, I've balked at this several times. But if you do your research, it helps a lot. You want to use meat type ratios, which I'll cover in the next slide. And you want to rotate your types of meat. Like, variety is the spice of life. What one meat might be missing, the next one I'll take care of. You can also consider supplements. My dog tends to be deficient in iodine a lot. And so I give her, like, seaweed to help with that. And you can also do that for other things that you think your dog might be lacking on. And again, observe your dog. They're going to tell you what they need. They're going to tell you what they want. And if you have that bond with them and you can listen to them, that'll help a lot. And what's helped me the most is you don't have to balance it every day. Think about your diet. You don't eat perfectly healthy every single day. You have really healthy days. You have not so healthy days. But you want to try and balance it out over the course of a week. Now, the meat ratios I was talking about is the 80-10-10 rule. You want 80% of the diet to be muscle, 10% to be bone, and 10% to be secreting organs. Half of that 10% should be liver. This is going to give you a pretty balanced diet overall as long as you keep this in mind. And so, let me go over. Here are ideas, because a lot of people are like, oh my goodness, I have to go and find all this crazy meat. And a lot of them buy it at the grocery store, which that can get pretty expensive pretty fast. But you can go to like a butcher shop and you can find all of these, really. And you can use them to help balance out your diet, add variety, etc. For an example, this is my baby. She's an 8-year-old Japanese Akita and is 90 pounds. And she has a plethora of problems that are a lot of fun to work with when trying to create a diet for her. So that's what really prompted me to look into raw is, I mean, she is getting old. She's got a little bit of arthritis. You know, that's all right. She does have bad teeth. She likes to break them. The breed itself is prone to hip dysplasia, but, you know, she seems to have some pretty set hips. And she likes to break out in hot spots if she eats anything that doesn't agree with her, which is kind of frequent. So to give you an example of how you would do a raw food diet, it's a rule of thumb that the daily intake weight for maintenance weight should be 2% of the body weight. So she's 90 pounds times 2%. Her total diet is going to be 1.8 pounds of food a day. Now we're going to break that into 80% muscle. That 1.8 pounds a day times 80%. 1.44 pounds of that diet is going to be muscle meat. So that's going to be like your heart and what we discussed on the previous slide. And the other 20% is going to be your bone and organ, and that is broken up accordingly if you look down. And I also broke the organ calculations in half because we previously stated that we want half of the organ to be liver to get it correctly balanced. So it's really not that difficult, and I was really set back by the concerns. Like, I take my vet's word like the Bible, to be honest. But the canine's body is physiologically designed to eat a raw diet. That's how they were developed, that's how they grew. And they have several defenses in place to protect them, like the very low stomach pH. They have strong teeth, they enjoy it, and you always feed raw bones. So the major things I want you to take away from this is to trust your dog and listen to them. They're going to tell you what they feel good on, what they don't feel good on, and you want to really take that into consideration. And raw feeding can be intimidating, but it's valid and it's going to be worth the work in the long run.
Okay, good. I got a question and some comments as long as we're recording. How about, I thought sometimes, sometimes people, instead of giving raw bones, they'll use bone meal. Have you heard of that? Or
mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay. That's usually, it's usually when you need to boost calcium.
Okay.
Like, especially if you have a pregnant dog. That needs a lot of calcium.
Okay.
But most people prefer to give raw bones because it also works their teeth and cleans them, scrapes off the tartar, strengthens them, and it's also just a behavioral enjoyment process.
And I think you made a good point. I can't remember the name of the book, but I know the author, and I should bring it to you so you can read it a little bit, or all of it. You made a point of the meal doesn't have to be balanced every day. Because, and you made the point, look at us. Sometimes I eat a lot, and sometimes I don't eat much. But your body stores a lot of things that can, you know, can get by. And this one book talks about how it doesn't have to be balanced every day. You know, like, but you made a good point. I think over a week, yeah, in, you know, in over some time, it should be balanced, but not, you don't have to do it every day. And the other thing is, really, you really need a good nutritionist to look at a diet. And there's a lot of websites. Have you done, are there some websites that you would recommend that says the raw diet, like any of those there or not?
I know
that these
are the sources that my classmate gave me.
Okay.
And they have been absolutely, they've been a lifesaver.
Are you talking about Hannah?
Yes.
Hannah gave you these. Yeah. So those are, you would recommend those. Yeah.
Yes. The Facebook group, that sounds like, I mean, I'm a scientific person, so I bulked at that one a little bit. But it's been great.
Really?
It helped with so many questions I've had. And but they're super nice. Uh-huh. And they really just jump in and they will tell you everything they know.
Yeah. Because there's a lot of people with a lot of history for raw feeding. It's not like new, like you said, you know. Because kibble is relatively new. And the problem I have with kibble, I think animals that eat kibble, dogs, tend to be more likely to have bloat. Because that stuff expands when it gets into the stomach. Whereas your raw food won't expand at all. It's already, you know, going to be as full as it is. So, yeah, and I know Hannah is my go-to person. Because I told you about her, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And she is like an expert as far as I'm concerned.
She's great.
Yeah. Okay, I think we're set.